So how real is the insect apocalypse? How might it affect us? And what have we recently learned about it? A lot of stuff. It's really an extraordinary story. Back a year and a half ago or thereabouts, there was this massive study and then a meta study that followed that, looking over a 27-year period at 63 specific areas, protected wildlife areas in Germany. And what they found was that there was a 76% decline in the total biomass of flying insects. I mean, this is like a disaster. And then another study found that this was the result, this is the more recent one, this is the result of land, mostly farmland, becoming 48 times more toxic than it was just 25 years ago. Now, what would make our land, particularly our agricultural land, so toxic to flying insects? Turns out it's the neonicotinoid insecticides. These are compounds. These are all pretty much all the ones used now are synthetic compounds, but they're based on nicotine. They've synthetically figured out how to make nicotine and or these variations on it. And they attack the nervous system of these insects, just throw them into, you know, spasm frenzies, and they die. They can't eat, they can't drink, they can't breathe, they just die. And these pollinators affect 35% of the world's food crop production. Maybe pointing out, I mean, you know, as Trump is eviscerating the EPA and the Endangered Species Act and the Interior Department and everything else, maybe pointing out that our food supply is at risk will do something to wake some of these folks up. It's hard to know, but we are all, you know, looking around as people calling into my radio program, for example, for years now, I've been pointing out that we just don't see the bugs on the windshields that we used to see, you know, just from 20, 30 years ago. Why? Because the insect apocalypse is here, and it's starting to affect our crops. In China, they're actually hand-pollinating certain orchards. This is not a good sign. We need to do something about this now. And the simple thing is very straightforward. Ban neonicotinoid insecticides. On the line with us is Tara Lohan. She's the deputy editor of The Revelator, an environmental journalist, editor of two books on the global water crisis. The Revelator, R-E-V-E-L-A-T-O-R.org is the website. Her Twitter handle is Tara Lohan, L-O-H-A-N. Tara, welcome to the program.
Thanks for having me.
Physicians for Social Responsibility and Concerned Health Professionals of New York both contributed to a massive study of studies, summarizing 1,700 scientific reports with regard to fracking. What conclusions did they draw?
They basically stated that they don't think that there's any way to do fracking in a way that is healthy and that no amount of regulation is going to make that process any safer. This group of studies that came out that they did, they called it a compendium, is actually the sixth time that they've amassed this information. 2014 was the first time the compendium came out, so they have been over the years accumulating these studies, summarizing them, grouping them into trend areas, and trying to help people digest all the science that's coming out and how many studies and what they're related to, and giving people a picture, an overview of what some of the threats might be. And some of that is to water and air, but also not just the moment that the wells are being drilled and fracked, but the entire process of getting this gas out of the ground and getting it either through pipelines or trucks to gas-burning power plants.
So how different is that from conventional oil drilling?
Yeah, well, so fracking can be used for both oil or for gas, and it's quite a bit different than the conventional method of drilling. It's a really industrialized process. I didn't really fully appreciate that until I went to some of the areas where this work was being done. You have a large site, a large area of land that needs to be cleared. The amount of what you're doing is blasting a lot of water and sand and chemicals underground. That means many, many truck trips, sometimes hundreds of truck trips a day that are bringing the water and sand and chemicals to these areas. It's quite an industrialization, often of rural and suburban areas. And that's just the fracking process. And there's also related infrastructure that needs to be built and developed, like pipelines and compressor stations. So it's a big process.
I've heard that after, fracking is basically cracking, creating huge networks of cracks in underground rock that allow the gas to be released or the oil to accumulate and be released. And that that process, in addition to, the possibility of unstable geology and all the, you know, the high pressure water and all the waste that it produces, that process in and of itself is absolutely unsustainable, in large part because the amount of gas that gets released only lasts somewhere between 3 and 10 years.
Certainly, this is an industry that requires a lot of money. Doing this is pretty expensive, and there have been a number of folks that have written about the financial implications and the industry sort of teetering on the edge, if you will. There is still booming industry, but we're finding a lot of smaller companies that are going out of business. They're being bought up by big companies. They need to keep drilling and fracking new wells in order to keep the industry going. And a lot of what's happening is you get cheap gas that's being produced, and we don't always need it, and they can't always use it. So in cases like a lot of places in the Bakken Shale in North Dakota, the gas is actually just flared off. It's not economical for them to get that to market. They're getting the oil to market, but not the gas. And so that is flared off. And then it's also, we're finding more on the east side in the Marcellus Shale, states like Pennsylvania and West Virginia, that a lot of this gas is being used to fuel the petrochemical industry. So they're producing more and more plastics.
What are the risks to people living right around fracking areas?
The compendium lists different sections that you can look into if you're concerned about things, but there's particular concerns to water. There are examples of well water and aquifers being contaminated with chemicals. There is a problem with water, the wastewater either being intentionally or unintentionally through a spill dumped into things like creeks and streams, and that gets into waterways that may go into drinking water that may impact wildlife. There are threats to the air, particularly the flaring of natural gas that comes out. You have methane, you also have other kinds of chemicals and hydrocarbons that are in the air. Another thing is that people don't exactly know everything that's involved in this process. The industry has been given some loopholes in the Clean Water Act and the Safe Drinking Water Act where they don't have to report all the chemicals. So in some cases, it's a bit of a mystery and people are extremely concerned. They may be feeling sick, but they don't know why, and they don't exactly know how to ask their health professionals for help or what to be looking for if they don't always know the chemicals. And that's one of the reasons why I think this compendium is important, and why I interviewed Dr. Sandra Steingraber about this for the story that I wrote on it, and she's one of the people that's been involved in this. Before this was a compendium in 2014, she was working on looking at all the science that came out before then and trying to look at the studies. And when she first started, there were only about 9 studies, peer-reviewed studies on some of the health impacts. And at that time, people were really trying to figure out, without knowing what the chemicals were in the fracking fluid, how they were being impacted. But since then, there's been a number of thousands more studies that have been done, and a much greater amount of information that can be gleaned from the various impacts.
One of the things that fracking chemicals do, at least from the literature that I've read, is kind of lubricate the rock. And so some of the chemicals that they put in are oil-based chemicals that apparently have that property. And I remember back 20, 30 years ago, there was this huge bust in upstate New York and New Jersey where the mafia had been going to companies that needed to dispose of toxic chemicals. And the law required these toxic chemicals to be burned in incinerators at very high temperatures. And so it was costing, in some cases, as much as $1,000 a pound to dispose of some of these toxic chemicals. And so the mob was, charging people a discount. Hey, we'll take care of it for $800 a pound. And then they were just simply diluting it with oil and spraying it on dirt roads out in rural areas. And this was discovered because a whole bunch of cancer clusters popped up. 60 Minutes did a big expose on it. I'm wondering if, that was a creative way, shall we say, of disposing of highly toxic waste that came out of the petrochemical industry. Is it conceivable that some of these fracking chemicals may, in other incarnations, be considered toxic waste?
I think one of the biggest problems with fracking and dealing with the impacts of it is not just the actual process of fracking, but it is trying to process all the waste that comes in with this great amount of water that comes out of the process. It flows back, and that water is sometimes being sent to water treatment plants that don't know all the chemicals in it. It is sometimes just being dumped. It is being put in California, where I live, into open pits that are unlined, and so in a lot of cases, it is being injected underground, which is thought of as being sort of the best method for getting rid of it. But as studies have also shown, that is leading to seismic impacts and is causing earthquakes in some places.
So in addition to all these other things and the chemical poisoning of people and ecosystems and environments, there's radiation associated with this?
Yeah, there is sometimes because, you know, this exists naturally underground, and when you're fracturing the rock and bringing up the water and chemicals that are underground, along with the hydrocarbons that the folks are after, you're also releasing other things that are underneath there. So that has been a threat in some communities as well.
So what can we do?
You know, the state of New York actually decided to ban fracking in 2014, and that was largely because folks like Concerned Health Professionals of New York got together and accumulated studies and said, hey, this is what's happening. These are the health impacts. And they went out to communities that were going to be on the front lines and said, this is the science that we've found. This is what you might be up against. And if you'd like to read these studies and take action and submit a comment, you can do that. And they engaged people in the public process by informing them with the science that was out there. And I think that's a good way of approaching things right now. When I was talking to Sandra Steingraber about this, she said that, you know, you would expect that science would stand on its own, that there would be enough, there's more than enough information here to say that we need, the process should be banned, that in many cases regulations wouldn't help, but it's not. And she said that it seems to be that science these days needs a powerful social movement behind it. And I think when she said that, it made me think about climate change. And I think that there's a lot of analogies to that right now, is that we need not just good science, but we also need people that are willing to get out there and make sure that it's heard.
It's the good, the bad, and the very, very squamously ugly. The good, Goldsmiths College. The University of London College, Goldsmiths, has banned the sale of beef in campus cafeterias to help tackle climate change. They're also phasing out single-use plastics and installing more solar panels in order to become carbon neutral by 2025. So come next month, beef products are out, and an additional 10 pence levy will be added to the sale of bottled water and disposable plastic cups. Good on you, Goldsmiths. The bad, the Trump administration, ignoring overwhelming public opposition. The Trump administration this week reauthorized the use of cyanide bombs to kill wild animals on public lands. Officially called M44s, Colette Adkins, carnivore conservation director at the Center for Biological Diversity, said the devices can't be used safely by anyone anywhere, noting that they kill target animals like coyotes, but also, as well, non-target animals, including foxes, bears, and family pets. Hopefully the Trump administration will reverse its decision, but you can help by calling your congressperson. And the very, very squamously ugly, again, the Trump administration. The economic and environmental costs of Trump's auto rollback, the auto exhaust standards, will be very, very high. According to the environmental group Energy Innovation, Trump's plan to freeze the fuel efficiency standards in defiance of California's stricter and more environmentally friendly plan will cost California $400 billion through 2050. Also, undoing this Obama-era rule will increase America's gas consumption up to 7 billion barrels. This then increases our U.S. transportation emissions by up to 10% by 2035. And that is very, very ugly. Our science fact of the day. Just in the month of June, the fires that are burning in the Arctic, particularly in Siberia, but all around the Arctic right now, as a consequence of global warming, have emitted, just in this one month, 79 million tons of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. 79 million tons of this stuff that is further blanketing the Earth and trapping heat and warming our planet. This is not a good thing.